focusing on enabling business model innovation, which is a really hard thing to do because when people are innovating, it's hard to really predict that. Mm-hmm. So it means that we're trying to build something very flexible and future-proof. So we have a lot of hard challenges in front of us. We do Scala, and that's really the language right now that we have centered on for the back-end services, and we're programming in Angular, as you can tell from the title of this talk, in Scala. And so if anyone's interested to talk to us about positions or anything like that, we are hiring, and Jeff here is our CTO, so you can grab him afterward or talk to me. So one of the things we talk about here is, it was about, like 4 or 5 months ago, we decided to kind of take the plunge into Scala as an organization. And that was pretty important, sort of pivotal moment in our team, because I was one of the only people who knew Scala at all. And I will go ahead and be frank with you, in fact, most of my Scala experience is, I would say, compared to every other language I have, it's the least amount of experience I have. But fortunately, I had some good mentors, and you know, I've learned a lot over the year or so that I was developing in Scala. We've done some fun stuff in Scala at Fox Commerce, and hoping to continue that. So one of the things we had to do when we were picking Scala is we knew that an e-commerce platform needs a pretty substantial data model. It's pretty complex. There are a lot of tables. There's a lot of data. There are a lot of relationships between that. So we really needed a good sort of database access library or abstraction to be able to manipulate all that data and the relationships. We went through a couple of options. There were some that were very much active record-like, if anyone's familiar with that. I know you are, done some Ruby. A couple other ORM choices. Certainly we could try to bolt on Hibernate. That would be probably a horrible idea. There was a few other options that I won't really go through. A Slick 3 at the time, I think, was just entering like beta release. And we looked at it, thought it made sense in the Scala ecosystem. Obviously, it's built by TypeSafe. So we thought they would have support out in the future. It seemed to be sort of functional, so we grabbed Slick. Little did we know that it was going to be quite a journey, I think, trying to learn how to sort of manipulate Slick in the way that we wanted. That's exactly why this title of the talk is a case study in Stockholm syndrome. We had to bash our heads against the wall quite a bit. And finally, I think at the end of it, the end result is something that looks pretty elegant. And I think we have more to do there, but pretty happy with the results. So why Stockholm syndrome? If anyone's familiar.
So you love your kidnapper.
Yeah.
Yes, pretty much.
That's right? What you're saying.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Love, maybe sympathize. And so Stockholm syndrome, for those who are not familiar with the concept, it's sort of a thing in psychology. And it's actually from an actual event where these hostages in Stockholm were held captive by, we call them terrorists. And it was a long enough period of time that the terrorists and the captors kind of started to have a bond with one another. And the captives actually started to express sympathy, sort of empathy towards their captors, which is now, it's well studied in psychology. It's a pretty interesting psychological phenomenon that people could actually be, in some senses, abused or held captive and express sympathy and empathy for their captors. So that's really what this is. We went through that pain. We went through sort of the violence of working with Slick, and in the end, I think, we can express sympathy towards sort of all the reasons why Slick has chosen certain ways to do things. So, all right, this I think pretty much sums it up what Stockholm syndrome is. It's exactly that. There was another really good one. I didn't want to put it.
I totally want that on the t-shirt.
Yeah. There was another good one about beer that. Basically, someone said, you should try this beer, it's tasty, and the person said, I have no taste for beer, I have no thanks, I don't like it, and the response was, no, it's an acquired taste, you just have to keep trying it continually until you like it. And I said, that's not an acquired taste, that's Stockholm syndrome, right? I think I disagree with that sentiment a little bit, so this handles it a little better. So, we're gonna start with sort of an outline. I want to give you an outline of what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to give an intro to Slick and sort of what it is, what it's not, kind of basic concepts overview. The concepts we'll go over will be related to, we'll start with types, the tables and models abstractions, queries and actions, and there are a couple other components in Slick that I won't get into, but there's enough resources for you to go learn, and I can provide you with those resources. I have a pretty comprehensive list at this point. We'll talk a little bit about the gotchas, you know, alternatively how Slick has tortured us, and how we use it, again, how we sympathize with our captor. And really this means how we've learned to work around some of the problems of Slick or sort of the shortcomings. So what is Slick? It is a RDBMS abstraction. So that means SQLite, MySQL, Postgres, etc. There was one instance, I think, of people trying to use Slick against MongoDB, and I don't know how all that's worked out. If you're using Scala and you have a Greenfield app, it'd be interesting to me to know why MongoDB would be a choice these days, but I think for us, we've converged on Postgres at our company, so this fits with us very well.
You have an excellent taste.
Yes, I do. Thank you, I appreciate that. So, Slick is an FRM library. It's a functional relational mapper. Does anyone know what that means?
I know what an object relational mapper is.
Sure.
But I don't know what...
It's a thing that almost always breaks.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Having written one myself, in PHP, it was an active record board.
I'm sorry.
To this day, yes. Worst thing I could have done for my entire life. There are still people trying to get that thing to work, and I haven't even really submitted a pull request in 2 years. It's incredible to me. So, no one.
So, I'm going to take a guess, because okay. I actually haven't, but you're mapping functional transforms to the set-based expressions that a relational database exposes.
That was an eloquent answer. Unfortunately, I don't know if you can say it's correct or incorrect, because...
Nobody knows what functional
transforms. I would love for you to Google... FRM white paper.
Okay.
Some definition, some consensus of what this actually means, I have been unable to find it at this point. So really, I think someone at TypeScript
made it up.
There's
a PhD in this for us.
That's right. Someone actually made this up, right? So
yeah.
They basically took the O out and said, if you put functional in there, Scala developers will converge.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
So much better.
Exactly.
This is a buzzword.
What's that?
It's a buzzword.
It's a buzzword. It's a buzzword.
It's a buzzword.
No marketing.
Ash FRM.
One of the things, though, in, you know, jokes aside, I think they're trying to avoid actually some of the baggage of ORMs, right? There's a distaste, I think, that we have for ORMs. I think if anyone's used an ORM and walked away from that and felt like it was probably one of the best tools that they used in their tech stack, I don't think you used it enough. Because I've never used a single ORM in any language or tech stack where I felt like it was one of the best tools.
Well, so, I mean, there, classically, the term is there's an impedance mismatch.
Absolutely.
Between object systems and relational systems. Relational systems talk in sets, and transformative algebra over sets.
Yes.
And object systems don't talk that way. They talk about instances of objects and what you do with them.
And usually
so
mutating
if you try to map one into another, you find there's a whole bunch of things that don't work well.
Yes.
But if you talk about functions all the time, functions can do transformations over sets.
Absolutely.
Right? You know, everybody knows map.
Yep.
And reduce.
I agree.
These are set transformation functions.
Yep. And
so,
I actually think this is why it's a good definition. And I think it's a good thing for them to distinguish this as a sort of against the stream of ORM, right?
Right.
And it's very important because part of ORMs as well is trying to model the associations or the relationships, and you generally get an object graph out of that, right? That's not something we do in Slick. That's actually something that sort of is painful at first until you realize there's a decent way to abstract these things. But getting on the impedance mismatch, it's true, there are some problems there. You will see in the Slick documentation that they hit on that very early on, and I actually think I disagree with some of their remarks on the impedance mismatch and impedance mismatch in general. There's a good article that I read the other day that it doesn't exist And I don't fully buy that argument, but I think it at least quelled some of the concerns or fears about the failures of ORMs and impedance mismatch. So one of the things that they outlined, though, is certainly efficiency with pre-optimization of queries, which is generally something that's hard to do with most ORMs. This is a thing that I think is a very specious claim, which is FRM brings type safety to building database queries, because ORMs can do that, and there's, of course, link, right? Which, good segue.
Smaller GPBC.
Yeah. And another thing is, this is highly inspired by link, to be honest. To get on your point, the constructing query, where you can build queries through collections like API, right? I would say that's probably really the definitive feature of Slick that sort of follows this idea that it's functional in a sense. Another big feature is that we construct queries with types that be like I went over. But this is very nice because we're also able to do this with, you can drill down into plain SQL in Slick, and you can still actually maintain type safety, which is, I think, a great feature. Another thing is, and as you can see, I put it in here, it's scare quotes. It's sold as reactive. If anyone can tell me what that means, would you like to try that?
Just put a TM after it.
Another buzzword, yes.
So it's from TypeSafe, right? So it's like has to throw reactive in there.
We scoff a bit, right? But you know, they have a manifesto. They offer some attributes and guidelines around what they think this means. And most people who read that are going to agree with most of it.
Yes, I think you can read it, and it will sound great. Basically, the idea is that, in some sense, it offers a little down. There's back pressure. You can do asynchronous programming, right, for the async, and it's fault tolerant, in a sense, right? Building these things, actually, from the ground up, if you don't have enough experience, it's hard. So it is nice that you can walk inside. You can use Slick, pull that in your library, and you do have something that is, call it, reactive.
You'll be magically buzzword compliant.
Absolutely. I mean, it's functional, and it's reactive. As I said, I hit on it. It's inspired by Link. My CTO Jeff should know what that is. I don't know if anyone else has done any sort of .NET development in Sharp. Link is sort of like a functional. It is kind of a functional approach. Mm-hmm. And type-safe, SQL, algebraic relational mapper on top of RDBMS, and it was. I think there was a white paper that came out. One of the people who built this idea was Eric Meyer.
Eric Meyer.
He has the best t-shirts in the whole world.
Yes.
So
this was like 2005.
It was a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And the fun thing, too, is that it's quite monadic in a sense, too. It's, mm-hmm. it's functional, too. So when people talk about monads, there's a joke that you may have invented monads or you may use monads and you have no idea that you are.
Select many is bind.
Yeah. So if you use link, you are actually using some functional constructs. Mm-hmm. So should talk about what Slick is not. It is not an ORM.
You skipped over the last bullet.
What's that?
It's maintained.
It's
by
built and maintained by TypeSafe.
Oh yes, I'm sorry. I did say that.
I know, but you skipped it. Which for some people is important. Like there's
yeah.
like an organization that actually cares about the future of the software and wants to actually make money by making sure it keeps working.
No one ever got fired for using IBM, Java, or TypeSafe. Is that right?
Yeah.
That's how the phrase goes.
There's an inertia of
certainly
attention and development and
then there's also type level. So there's inertia and a divergence of the communities, unfortunately.
Yeah, there you go.
Is it open source?
Yes. However,
that's
if you like to connect to Oracle or Microsoft SQL Server, you will pay a license. That is commercialized. There is a fork of the Slick project right now that's called FreeSlick that offers support for those. And there's actually quite a bit of drama that came up in the community because of it. I wasn't involved in Slick at the time, so I didn't really know, but you can find it on GitHub.
If you want to connect to Postgres, it's that's open source? Is it MIT or do you know what kind of license it is?
I actually, for Postgres, for the open source ones, I'm sorry, I don't remember what the license is for them. I apologize, I should know. So, obviously, we've covered this. It's not an ORM. But you should really let that sink in, because there are a lot of benefits from using an ORM that
because
are derived.
Scala is also an object-oriented language.
Turns out it's multi-paradigm, right?